If you haven't done so yet, please pause the video and try to answer this question on your own before listening on. We can see from the description here that we have a metal wire that is being slid through a magnetic field. That metal wire in the picture is present right here. And we know that if a metal wire that's carrying a current is moving through a magnetic field, then it will experience a magnetic force. Let's take a look at the equation that gives us the magnitude of that magnetic force. So the magnetic force, which can be symbolized as F sub B, is equal to the product of the current that's flowing through the wire, the length of the wire, the magnitude of the magnetic field, and then the sine of an angle. Now this angle will be between the current, which is I, and the magnetic field, which is B. And hopefully we can see from the picture that the angle between the magnetic field and the current is 90 degrees. We have the current flowing to the right, and then the magnetic field is pointing straight up. And so the angle between the two will indeed be 90 degrees. Now, that is the only force acting on the wire, and we know that from Newton's second law, that the net force that's acting on an object is equal to its mass times its acceleration. So we can substitute in MA for the magnetic force. Now, we also know from kinematics that the acceleration is equal to the change in velocity divided by the time. Now, the initial velocity of this wire is actually zero. So when we write out the change in velocity, we would have the final minus the initial. But because the initial is zero, we can actually write that as just the final velocity divided by the time. So we're going to substitute in V over T in for the acceleration A. And then since part A is asking us for that magnitude of the velocity, or in other words, the speed, we want to solve this equation for V. So why don't we multiply both sides of the equation by the time T, as well as divide by the mass M. And then at this stage of the problem, we can plug in all the known values. The current I was given to us in milliamps, so just remember to multiply that by 10 to the minus 3, so you can convert that into the standard unit of amps. The length of the wire was given to us as well, and that is 2.56 centimeters, so we're going to have to multiply that value by 10 to the minus 2 in order to convert it into meters. The magnetic field was given to us as well, and it was given in millitesla, so we'll have to multiply that by 10 to the minus 3. The angle, as noted, was 90 degrees. The time is given to us in milliseconds, so we'll multiply that by 10 to the minus 3. And then the mass, finally, is given in a non-standard unit, and to convert that into kilograms, we'll actually have to multiply that by 10 to the minus 6. So with all of those conversions, let's plug into the equation for the speed. So after plugging that in and crunching it all down, you should get approximately 3.34 times 10 to the minus 2 meters per second. So this would be the correct answer to part A. And for part B, to predict the direction of motion of this wire, we're going to have to use the right-hand rule. So what we want to do is first draw a picture of a right hand. So here is an attempt at drawing a right hand, and we've oriented the hand in a very particular way. You'll notice that the thumb of the right hand is pointing in the same direction as the current. The fingers, on the other hand, are pointing in the same direction as the magnetic field, which is straight up. And so if you orient your right hand in that fashion, you'll notice that your palm, which is supposed to be in this region here, would be facing to the left. That leftward facing direction is the direction of the magnetic force. And we can see that it is indeed pointing to the left. So the direction of motion of this magnetic force is actually going to be to the left. So that means that this wire is going to be sliding to the left. And so this is the correct answer to part B.